Hi, boys and girls, it's me. And to my right or to your left, you're going to see a Zenith shuttered aisle chassis on my bench, and it's my 12S267. I believe that's the right number. Excuse me while I look. Yes, 12S267. The last numbers, or the last three numbers, really kind of just correlate to the type of cabinet, but it's a 12-tube shuttered aisle chassis, and it's the one I picked up for a really smoking good price at a JD auction several months back. That was the same auction where I ended up spending over, well to the four-figure number, and I've never done that for any radio or radios or whatever. So, I did a little work on my other shutter dial chassis this morning, and I was checking on the dial belts, and I lubricated things and made sure everything was happy. But then I never really kind of paid much attention to the dial belts on this one. Now, this radio was kind of weird in the respect that they moved the on-off switch over here. Okay, the gentleman that worked on this, because come to find out that this switch here, I can't even move it. Probably easier if I had the knob on it. This didn't work, the on-off switch, which is typically over here. So what he did was he just changed the volume control and put it on this shaft. And that's how the radio turns on and off now. So, and then this doesn't matter whether it's on local or distance or whatever. It just picks up distance. I'm fine with that. But I never really thought, you know, to look at the dial belts. I was so impressed with the underneath. They had Nichicon caps and the bypass and coupling caps were orange drops. I mean, this was, he wasn't shy about spending money on this. But there is a good side to this, and that is, if you look over here, I do have a dial belt, okay? But if this was back in the radio, and I had this all together, and I had this lit up, but I wanted to use the motorized tuning, you could hear something, but nobody's home. So I figured, well, this might be a good time to do this together. I'll just share this with you to repair and tell you what I do. I did a video on this a long time ago, probably a couple years back, on my 9-tube shutter dial. But we'll just do the same dance on this one. But I also picked up a few little tricks that I learned, you know, this time around that I didn't know about whenever I did that video 5 years ago or wherever. So let me share that with you. But first of all, before we get started on this, I want to talk a minute about the InfoWave Science and History Center in Belmar, Wall Township, New Jersey. It's very, very close to the Asbury Park area, Neptune and that area over there. It's actually a piece of history in and of itself, because in 1914, on the same grounds, Marconi sent a Morse code message across the ocean. It was picked up in England, albeit a spark gap, so, you know, naturally the spectrum was a little bit on the wide side, but that was still a stellar thing to do back in 1914. So, that being said, it's not just the New Jersey Antique Radio Club Museum on there. There's a bunch of museums on there. There's probably about 10 of them. Also, there's a lot of World War II history there. There's a submarine museum. If you're into vintage, like I'm an old car guy. If you're into vintage cars, they have a vintage military vehicle museum there, and the gentleman runs there. That is just he's incredibly smart, and they have some really unique vehicles in there. One of them, which is my personal favorite, is it's a Jeep that was made by Ford, and it was contracted by the government to have Ford make these Jeeps during World War II. However, only six was made, and the reason for that was it was a four-wheel drive Jeep, and these guys were flipping them. So Ford, or the government got a hold of Ford, and after he made six of them, and said, listen, just don't make any more, because guys were wrecking them. It was a full-time four-wheel drive vehicle. Got that. You've got the Vintage Computer Federation. So if you have young kids that are interested in computers, and you want to see some really, really early computers and some early video gaming computers, you know, the old 8-bit, 16-bit stuff, come see that. And it just goes on from there. So I want to get started on this, and you probably do too. And by the way, I'm going to be down at museum, the New Jersey Antique Radio Club Museum, this Saturday. I think that's the 2nd or 3rd. I forget. I don't have my schedule on me, but I think it's the 3rd. And I work there. sometimes as it does it. So this coming Saturday, I'll be there. If you want to come there this Saturday and you stop by the museum, you may see me there. I'd be glad to give you a tour and show you all the stuff around. Let's get started on this. Alrighty, so here's the underneath of the chassis of the 12 tuber, and as you can see here, look at all these orange drops that were put in here. Somehow this little polyester guy got snuck in there, but most of these guys are seriously nice, expensive orange drops. Nice resistors, a few resistors that needed to be replaced. These are Nichicons. I mean, it's just a thing of beauty. There's a couple of Nichicons up here. So, you know, the gentleman that did the work was not shy about spending money on his work. God bless his soul. But the thing is that I can tune the radio, because if you see right here, as this guy is spinning around, that's the tuner. That's what's moving the bread slicer around, okay? So this actually has a leather belt, although you can see here, I don't know how well it's going to come through on the picture, you can see it's peeling away, and that's going to go away eventually. And here's the motor for the motorized tuning wheel. So in other words, there's actually a belt that goes around this pulley here and then around this pulley. And then this outside, I don't know how well this is coming through, but let me point, this outside pin here, there's a knob on that. So if you move it one way or the other, this can be turned either clockwise or counterclockwise, and there's supposed to be a belt here, and nobody was home. So I figured this is a good opportunity just to do everything to this that I did to the 9-tuber. Now for a second time, I did it probably, I don't remember, it could have been even as long as 10 years ago. But there was a problem with this belt here on that one. And that was a neoprene belt, but I think what happened, well, I'll explain that in a little while. But since there was no belt on this one, one of the things I wanted to do was I took just a small drop of oil on a cotton swab and went into these points here so that the motor tunes fairly freely. So once the belt goes on here and I lubricate this up and everything, that should be able to turn the dial fairly freely. So I don't have to worry about too much. The belt's gone here. We're going to replace this one, and I have two brand new belts right here. This belt is going to be for the motorized tuning, and this is the belt that's going to replace this here. Now, the belts I used to get from a supplier, I believe in Michigan, they went out of business. However, there's quality dot radio dial belts, or quality radio belts. Here's the address here. Let's get it in front of the camera. Okay. And they sell belts. I kind of like these a little bit better because the diameter belt is a little bit bigger and thicker. It's welded together. I guess they ultrasonically weld that. They don't glue that, I don't think. But it's on there really, really well. And I think this is going to do a better job of gripping than the old neoprene belts I used to get off the other supplier. So let's go ahead and start taking this apart. First things first, got to take this screw off here so I can pull off this centerpiece here. Okay, now to get this rod out of this coupling right here, I should use this instead of my finger here. What I've done is, now you could put the knob that was on here back on here. I just happen to have, this is the smallest pair of locking vice grips that I have. So what I'm going to do is, I got to find my screwdriver. I don't know what I did with it. Oh, here it is. And this has a nut driver for this screw on the end. So all I do is pull this guy down and allow me to get access to this. Put it on here, unscrew it a little bit. Take that, whoop, I didn't mean to do that. Well, I can leave that on there, ain't gonna hurt nothing. But now I can pull that out. All right, so that's getting started with that. Now, while we're still chammering away here and talking, the next thing we're gonna do is I wanna just basically indicate this pulley here. So I'm gonna do is kinda give a little, it's not literally up against it, there's just a little bit of a gap here. And I'm gonna do the same thing on this side. So after I get this out, I'll take this wheel off and then loosen this up and start pulling these guys out. forgot to loosen this up too, the screw. And then I can start moving that. Oh, it's too big. There we go. Now I can pull this guy off. By the way, I forgot to make mention that before you start doing this, make sure you turn the dial to the low end of the dial by 540, 530 KC. And that way the bread slicer slices, so to speak, or the fins will be out of the way, and that'll allow you to easily access the dial belt when we go to pull that off and put the new one on. You'll see what I'm talking about with that. So now I can get that out of the way. This guy should slide off. Actually, I could probably even get the... Oh, come on. Come on. All right, I'll just pull this guy out the front. There we go. There's a little washer that just fell down in here. That's it. And then this piece can go here. And now, that frees up the belt. So now what I'm going to do is go in through the top of the radio, and since the bread slicer is now open there, there's just enough of an opening there, I could take this belt off. And just for the record, here's the dial belt that was still good, and holding things together, but you can see how much this was delaminating. You can see the gaps in the belt here and here. So it just would have been a matter of time before it went bad. Now, before I put the other one on, what I want to do is I'm going to take the center rod anyway. I'm going to put a little bit of light grease on it. Oh, here, let me push this in so I can got some room here. I'm going to clean this up a little bit. Maybe I'll just use some alcohol on there, clean this, and then some very light grease on here, and then slide this back into that brass tube. I put a little light grease on this rod too, maybe about just enough to cover this shaft here, so it's probably about 3 inches, so I probably put a little bit more on there. And just slide that in. Okay, like so. That's probably a little too much, so let me just take some of this off. But it'll still be a good enough amount to get everything to slide back on there, and then we can get our new belt in place. Okay, I guess you can see the... Here, I'll pull this out through here. Like so. And I am literally on the pulley. I don't know how well that's coming through in the picture, but that's literally on the pulley. So, life is good. Now I just gotta pull the belt in behind here, put the washer and these other pieces back on it, get it indexed, and then I can put that back together. Okay, so that's basically how you want to get that on there. Now I still have these two screws here loose, because I have to go down here now, get that other pulley that we're going to need for the motorized tuning, get that indexed and get it to this spot, and then get that all back together, and I can, once I get that where it's supposed to be, we'll tighten that all up. One thing I did here off camera that I didn't show you that I've been doing to the pulleys, what I'll do is I'll just take some either denatured alcohol or isopropyl like I've got here, you know, generic 70%, which is enough. I know I don't drink that stuff. Put this guy... Take the insides where the belt's gonna ride, and just clean off all the old dirt and everything. Just I'm just using this cloth and full alcohol, and I clean that up, and I also clean the surface of that up. And that way, once I put the belt on it, there shouldn't be any slippies or anything silly going on there. I don't know why this is so hard. That should go on fairly easily, I would think. All right, you know what I'm going to do? Let me get this. Oh, man. This is a bear. I'm going to just take a, I'll take a cotton swab and just put just a wee bit of oil inside that bushing on that the roller, and that hopefully will help that go on easier. These are little things that sometimes other creators don't show. Okay, so this is a cotton swab, and I put a little 3-in-1 oil in here, just a little bit. And Frank Zappa has a song of his, something like Keep It Greasy So It Goes Down Easy. Kind of the same thing. I don't have to force this guy on here. I don't know why this is so tough. Oh, there it goes. There it goes. All right. All right, life is good. I just have to make sure I've got it. Okay, that's the index mark. All right, so we got there. There, let's take the belt. All right, we'll put the belt on the wheel, and then we'll just bring it up here. Start sliding this guy in, get it on there. It wasn't on the line; it was just off the line a little bit, like that, maybe like that. And we'll just tighten that up. We'll tighten one screw first. Whoop. That one slipped a little bit. Maybe I'll just tighten it up with a screwdriver first. Instead of trying to do too much at one time here. Now, one thing I neglected to check last time when I did the 9-tuber was the motor actually has a little bit of play in it. So it's imperative that when this goes back together, like that, you pretty much want this to have just enough so it's not like off the roller, you know what I'm saying? All right. So let me get this guy in. Whoop, I put that in too far. See, the flat is going to be there. Let me push this down. Put that in like so. We'll tighten this guy up. And then we'll see how much, if this thing is fairly centered or not. Because I think I didn't have it centered on the 9-tuber. And it might have been pulling on the, like it's doing here. It's off, you can't really see it, but it already messed up the other belt a little bit. So you want to make sure that, I guess what I'm trying to say is you want to make, when you get ready to tighten these guys down, you want to make sure that these belts are straight up and down or as straight up and down as it's going to be. Even with this motor, it's going to want to go back and forth a little bit. So you just want to get that thing as centered as you could possibly get it. And it's finished. Okay, everything is tightened. So again, you want to look at it and make sure that it's not going to be, here, just let me hold it. I was doing everything on a tripod, but you can see there's a little bit of play in that thing, and the belt is still relatively straight up and down. That's what you want to go for. Same thing here, this is for the dial. Everything's nice and straight. Okay, so those are the two new belts. Let's put it in the radio and see how it works out. Okay, it's in the chassis, kind of sort of all back together. So let's give this thing a test run and see how it looks. Wow, look at that. I like that. Go the other way. Uh-oh. Nah. I hear the motor trying, but it ain't going nowhere. Let me see if I can give it some help here. Nope. Okay, so ooh, I don't know what that was. I ain't gonna do nothing. I can do this by hand. Now it's not going either way.
That's kind of interesting. All right, so, all right, we got two dial belts on there, and maybe this motor is really weak. I mean, these things had a tendency to, from what I've read on some stuff on the internet about these motorized tuning deals, is that after you run it for a little bit, then they start to get a little bit slower and everything else till they cool off. So now this kind of leaves me with a philosophical question here. I'm going to probably end the video here. Please remember to like, share, and subscribe. That'd be greatly appreciated. Should I blow this thing back apart and see if I can just lubricate every single moving part on that tuner and maybe take the motor apart and try it that way? Or in the other room, this is my boneyard room, and I have some tubes and some other things going on here. But here's the getting back to the philosophical question. I'll pull this out a little bit. I don't know how good, the light isn't very good over here. But what that is in that plastic tub is a complete, absolutely complete 9-tube shutter dial chassis. It even has the knobs on it. Now, being this is a 9-tube, I didn't look underneath of it, but if there's, you know, a motorized tuning motor on it, do you take a completely unrestored but complete 9-tube chassis, take the motor off of that and put it on a 12-tube to make the 12-tube go? So, please leave all your, you know, if you have something to say, put it in the comments. I'm going to read all the comments and see where to go with it from there. I hope you enjoyed the video, and maybe I'll see you August the 3rd at InfoAge at the NJARC Museum. So take care. Bye.